All right, thank you. So first of all, I'd like to thank the organizers for inviting me, and it's always nice to be back in Singapore. So I'm going to talk about my joint work with Kevin Costello. It's about integrability appearing in supersymmetric gauge theories. So I'm going to talk about two of the arguably most famous quantum integral systems, and they are actually equivalent. So one is the XYZ spin chain. It's a one-dimensional quantum mechanical spin system. They interact by nearest neighbor interaction. So that's this one. Or equivalently, statistical mechanical lattice model. That's the 8-vertex model in which spins are located at the edges of the lattice. And over the past decade or so, these integrable systems have been found to arise from various quantum field theory setups. So I don't think I will have time to explain all of them, but I will focus on those highlighted here. So the first one is 2D, 3D, 4D gauge theories with 4 supercharges. So that's something people call 2D version of Nekrasov-Schuss really corresponds. The second is 4D, 5D, 6D gauge theories with 8 supercharges. That's 4D Nekrasov-Schuss-Feely corresponds. And finally, and this is sort of like the main character of my talk. So it's 4D transforms theory. So it's a 4D analog of transforms theory. It was invented by Kevin Costello and was studied by him and his work with Witten and Yamazaki. So so it's kind of strange that the big question we'd like to answer is that why does a single quantum integrable system, so XYZ spin chain or equivalently 8-vertex model, appear in multiple quantum field theories setups? Why? So it's a big why we wanted to answer, and our answer is the following. So these quantum field theory setups are different descriptions of the same physical system, and all related by dualities in string theory. Okay, so that's the answer we gave. And there's another motivation for this work. So that's to understand 4D transforms theory. So I'll explain this, but 4D transforms theory has a fairly direct relation to integrable lattice models. But it's a very strange theory, at least from physicist's point of view. I'll explain why it's strange. And we found a reason that explains why it's a strange theory in our paper. And the reason is 4D transform theory is actually secretly a 6-dimensional theory. So it arises rather naturally from 6-dimensional maximally supersymmetric Yamil's theory. And so we gave a 6-dimensional formulation of 4D transform theory, which in turn allows us to embed this 6D theory into string theory, and then start using string dualities to go to different duality frames, which produce different quantum field theories. Okay. So my talk is, first I explain the motivations, so that's done. And next, I'm going to explain what 4D transform theory is and how it's related to integrable lattice models. And then after that, I'll explain how 4D transforms arises from 6D. Then I'll embed the 6D theory into string theory, and then apply some change of dualities and explain how these dualities produce other quantum field theories, and then I'll summarize and give some outlook. Okay, so first, so let me explain 4D transform theory and its relation to integrable lattice models. So what's 4D transform theory? So, well, it's a 4D version of transform theory. Well, but it's very strange, as I told you, in the following sense. So it can't be defined on our arbitrary full manifold. The spacetime has to be of this form, sigma times C, where sigma and C are each a surface. But C can only be either the complex plane, or C star, the punctured complex plane, or an elliptic curve. Okay? And this is gauge theory, but it has a complex gauge group, so GC. And moreover, its action functional is also complex, and it takes this form. And notice that, all right, so I have a transaminase 3 form here, but in order to have an action, I need a 4 form, so I can integrate over sigma times C. So in order to get the 4 form, I just take dz from a differential on C and wedge it to get a 4 form. It looks very ad hoc, but it works. Okay, and here, well, I have h bar, and that's a Planck constant, but it can be, in general, complex. Okay, moreover, so this transaminase 3 form is constructed from a partial connection in the sense that, in the following sense, so I use x and y for coordinates on sigma, and z, that's the complex coordinate on C, then a is ax dx plus ay dy plus az bar dz bar, and there's no z component, okay? And these curly ax and curly ay mean that they are complex valued, so I have a real part and complex part, all right? And real part is the real connection. And on the other hand, if you look at the z bar component, it's constructed out of the ordinary real connection, but it's a z bar component, so it's also complex. Okay, so this is very strange. In particular, the action is not bounded from Bois. So one may ask, how can you make sense of this theory? Okay, so what to do? Nevertheless, well, one can proceed, forget about all those strange points. Well, you can do perturbation theory. And that's what Kevin did in its original work, and as well as in his work with Witten and Yamazaki. So let's forget about that and then just try to compute something in doing perturbation theory. Okay? So much like ordinary transaminase theory, basic observables of 4D transaminase theory or Wilson lines, W alpha. Here alpha is just a label, distinguishing different Wilson lines. So it's the holonomy, traceable holonomy of the gauge field. But now remember that there's no Z component in curly A, so you can only take holonomy around one cycles, not K alpha, that sits inside sigma, and supported at some points Z alpha in C, okay? And you compute the holonomy and then take the trace in some representation V alpha. Now, but anyway, we have Wilson lines, so we can start, we can introduce Wilson lines to the theory. And to do that, let's take sigma to be a torus and take a number of Wilson lines and wrap those Wilson lines around one cycles of the torus. Then a picture looks like this. So here I have 5 Wilson lines either going horizontally or vertically on torus, and they are sitting at 5 different points on C. Okay, what I get is a lattice made out of Wilson lines. So what you're interested in is the correlation function of this configuration of lattice of Wilson lines. So now, how do we compute the correlation function? Well, you do use sum over Feynman diagrams. But the important point is, for each transaminase theory, well, it's not fully topological theory, but it's a hybrid topological holomorphic theory. And it's topological on sigma, but it's holomorphic on C. Okay, so it's topological on sigma because when you write down the Lagrangian, you don't have to introduce metric on sigma. You also don't have to introduce a metric on C, but you need a complex structure on C. So the theory is not topological on C, but it's holomorphic on C. Okay. So in any case, we have topological invariance C sigma, and this actually implies that the correlation function of Wilson lines factorizes into local contributions associated to vertices. So here, this is a picture of a neighborhood of an intersection of two Poisson lines, alpha and beta. And you consider such a neighborhood and compute the path integral for this neighborhood first. Okay? What do you get? So what you get is actually an endomorphism of V alpha tensor V beta. So you have some initial particle, initial state on the Poisson line, on the alpha Poisson line, tensored by some initial state on the beta Poisson line. And then they come together, those particles come together and then scatter off, and you get some final states here and here. Okay? So if you compute a path integral, what you get is a linear map from V alpha, V beta to itself. Okay, so you get a linear map like this. So that's the local contribution coming from the neighborhood of an intersection. And this linear map is called an R matrix. Okay, so this is just local contribution. In order to get the whole answer for the whole torus, what you have to deal with, you have to glue the local results back together to reconstruct the torus. Okay, then what do you do? So here you have a lattice, and then you have to pick, you choose a configuration of states supported on each of the edges of the lattice. So here I choose state ij and kl here. Then from this part, I get a contribution, this matrix element. So that's the contribution coming from this part of the lattice. Okay? But what you have to do is you compute all such local contributions, multiply them together. There are as many as local contributions as the number of vertices. And then you finally sum over all possible states you can choose. So all possible configurations of states. But if you think about it, the right-hand side is nothing but the partition function of some lattice model. So here, you can view this as spins placed on the edges of the lattice. Okay, so these circles are really spin states. And then you consider configuration of spins, such state variables. And then, in the lattice model, what you do is you compute the Boltzmann weights, okay, and then you sum over configurations. And here, local Boltzmann weights are encoded in the R matrix. All right, so just from the structure of 2D topological quantum field theory with line operators, you can say that the correlation function of such lattice of line operators must be the partition function of some lattice model. Okay? But 4D transform theory is not just topological theory on sigma, because it also has this direction C, which you may call extra dimensions. All right, so 4D transform theory has these two extra dimensions, and the existence of such extra dimensions implies the following. So first, each line operator, Poisson line, carries a parameter, which is just the location of the line operator on C. Okay? So each Poisson line comes with a continuous parameter, which is called the spectral parameter. And second, if you define something called the transform matrix, T alpha, which is just nothing but this picture, so you have a loop of a horizontal Poisson line, alpha's Poisson line making a loop horizontally, and that's intersected by vertical Poisson lines. And this picture defines an endomorphism of the Hilbert space here, living here. So that's the tensor product of the individual Hilbert spaces of the Poisson lines. So this is called the transform matrix. But you can make many transform matrices because we have many horizontal lines. But if you take two transform matrices, then they commute So you have T alpha, T beta, and the commutator being zero. Okay, or pictorially, you have this picture. So this is because you have a topological invariance on sigma. So sigma in this case is this screen, right? So you, what you do is you can take, for example, alpha, the bottom horizontal line, you slide it up, okay? You can do that due to topological invariance. And you may say that something funny can happen when alpha, the bottom, the horizontal line hits the top horizontal line. And so you may argue that, well, there's a topology change and something singular can happen, but this does not happen because these lines are located at generically at different points on C. Okay, so everything is smooth. So you can just slide one of the horizontal Wilson lines past the other, and you go from here to here. Okay, so transform is just commute. In turn, this equation implies that you have a series of commuting conserved charges because you have this spectral parameter, you expand the transfer matrix in that parameter in powers of z, and then each coefficient is again an operator on this space, and they commute. So you, yeah. When alpha is equal to beta, that's trivially zero. The left hand side is going to be trivially zero when alpha is zero. Right, so I'm assuming, generic situation is generic. So they are located at different points on C. Let me see. That's possible. If the two horizontal Wilson lines are the same Wilson lines, then left hand side is going to be trivially zero. But in general, situation can be complicated, but. Sure, yeah. So, yes, that's true. So, yeah, but generically, this is what happens. So, the existence of extra dimensions implies, together with the topological invariance on sigma, implies that you have a series of commuting conserved charges, and therefore the lattice model, which arises from this theory, is integrable. And in fact, you can say slightly stronger, the R matrix actually is a solution of the Young-Box equation. Okay. And you can calculate the R matrix for 4D transform theory by perturbation theory, and here's what you get. So for C equals the complex plane, what you get is something called the rational R matrix for the rational six-vertex model. If you replace the complex plane by C star, you get the trigonometric six-vertex model. Okay, and for each case, you can compute the what the conserved charges are, and you have a series of conserved charges. But that series include the Hamiltonian for XXX spin chain or XXZ spin chain, respectively. And in this sense, these models. Lattice models are equivalent to these spin chains. In the elliptic case, things are a little more complicated, and what you get is something called Felder's elliptic dynamical R matrix, which carries an extra parameter, lambda, and that's due to the fact that you have some degrees of freedom associated not only on the lines, but also on the faces of the lattice. So that's what you get. But it turns out that this R matrix is related by conjugation to Baxter's elliptic R matrix for the eight-vertex model, which is equivalent to the XYZ spin chain. Okay, so that's something you can calculate. Now, So that was, I mean, you get on the boundary, you get a 3D theory.
Sorry?
On the boundary, you get a 3D theory, and which upon dimension reduction should reduce to something like this minimum. So 4D Chansang theory reduces to 3D, ordinary 3D Chansang theory by dimension reduction. So I... Yeah, but that's for 3D Chansang theory and boundary on the 3 manifold with boundary. But here I'm talking about 4D version. So everything has to be... Yeah, well, I haven't really studied, I haven't studied that, but what I'm saying is that you should get something like a lifting, some kind of lift of something like this minimum width to 3D.
Is it just easy to
attack in
weight?
No, yeah, that's possible. But yes, I see. Right here, no one has studied that. Yeah. But that's, I guess, is an interesting direction. So I just explained how 4D Chansang theory is related to these models. So let me now explain how 4D Chansang theory arises from six-dimensional theory. So what you have to consider is six-dimensional maximally supersymmetric Yamil's theory. So it's a dimensional reduction of 10D super Yamil's. And therefore has four scalar fields, phi mu, which come from the components of the 10D gauge field along the compactified directions. And there's a spin four R symmetry, which rotates the four scalars. Okay. Now take this 60 maximally super Yamil's theory, put it on the six manifold of the form M times C, where M is a four manifold. And C is as before. Okay. Now, what you do is you topologically twist this theory along M. Okay. By this, I mean I replace the rotation group on M by that's spin 4 M by spin 4 M prime, which is a diagonal subgroup of spin 4 M times the R symmetry group. Okay. So what happens is that scalars are then no longer scalars, because they are rotated by spin 4R, so they become components of one form on M. And then you can show that there is a supercharged Q in the twisted theory that is scalar on M and satisfies these equations. So first of all, Q squared is zero, so you can consider Q cohomology. And then you can show that del mu, where mu is the del mu, so that's a translation generator along M direction. Directions on M, that they are Q exact. Similarly, if you consider del Z bar, that's also Q exact. Okay, but this shows that once you restrict your attention to Q cohomology, then these operators are just zero, which means that this twisted theory is topological on M, but in C direction, it's holomorphic because only del Z bar is zero. So you get a hybrid topological holomorphic theory in 6D by topological twist. Now, now take further specialize the choice of the four manifold M to this form, R2 times sigma. Okay. Now, and you can view this 6D theory from the point of view of R2. Okay, you can formally describe this 6D theory as a 2D theory on R2. Okay. Then it turns out that from the point of view of R2, this theory has n equals 2 comma 2 supersymmetry, but with a topological twist, and that's B twist. So you can view this 6D theory as some kind of B-twisted n equals 2 comma 2 supersymmetric gauge theory. But then the price you pay is that now things are very complicated. So gauge group is now infinite dimensional. It's the space of maps from sigma times C to the gauge group of the 6D theory. And you now have to decompose the 6D multiplet into the multiplet of n equals 2 comma 2 supersymmetry in 2D. Then, of course, you get a vector multiplet, which comes from the vector multiplet in 6D, but you also find there are three adjoint curl multiplets. They come from A3 plus I53, A4 plus I54, and AZ4. Okay? So we get three adjoint curl multiplets in the 2D language. And finally, it turns out that you have to turn on some kind of super potential in order to reproduce the correct 6D Lagrangian in the language of 2D supersymmetry. And this super potential takes this form. Okay? It's actually up to a factor. It's just the action of the 4D transform theory. Okay? So super potential, remember, is a holomorphic function of chiral multiplet scalars. And so that's this. Now, so there's a hint, well, this is a hint that this 6D topological homomorphic theory has something to do with 4D transform theory, okay? No, it's kept, well, it's there. It's still there. So one way to think about this theory is, right, suppose sigma and C are compact, then you can just do Kaluza-Klein thingy, but keeping all Kaluza-Klein modes, then you get a 2D theory on R2 with towers of Kaluza-Klein modes, so but you're not discarding any information. Sigma times C. Yeah.
So you need to solve the topological mirrors between
sigma. No, I'm not doing. I'm not doing that either. I mean, sigma and C are just kept intact. It's there. Right, so that's what I'm saying. So you can mode expand all fields along sigma and C, so you get many, infinitely many fields in the language, in the 2D language. Okay, it's just a very, very vastly complicated 2D theory. Yeah, but because you're not discarding any Kaluza-Klein modes, I mean, that 2D theory with infinitely many fields is just 6D theory. It's equivalent to 6D theory. So that's one way to think about it. Yeah, 2D theory is, yeah, Wilson line is going to be located, some local operator located at the origin of R2. Yeah. Yeah, that's right. And so Q invariant. Now, in order to really get 4D transform theory, so what you have to do is omega deformation. So in general, if you give me a B-twisted gauge theory in 2D on R2, then I can turn on some kind of deformation. It's called omega deformation. And after the deformation, Q doesn't square to zero anymore, but it squares to rotation generator. And there's this epsilon parameter, that's the omega deformation parameter, which is in general a complex number. Okay, but what the why I want to do this is that if you do this, then the path integral of the 2D theory simplifies a lot, and it reduces to this form, where W is a superpotential and phi naught is just a zero mode or constant part of the chiral multiplet scalar. And then 1 over epsilon appears here, and then you have gamma mod GC. So G is the gauge group of the of this B-twist gauge theory, but you get you have a complex complexified gauge group, and gamma is integration contour, but gamma is constructed from by solving some kind of gradient flow equation. Actually, gradient flows generated by the real part of W over epsilon. Okay, but gamma, but this mechanism gives gamma, which is such that this integral converges. And it's what people call, well, gamma is something called Lipschitz thimble. Okay? But if you look at this formula, it's just nothing but the path integral for zero-dimensional gauged sigma model on gamma, whose action is just given by W with H bar given by epsilon, okay, with gauge group GC. All right, so omega deformation reduces the 2D theory to 0D theory. Now, let's take this mechanism and apply this six-dimensional twisted theory on R2 times C, sigma times C, viewing this as 2D theory on R2. Okay, because 2D theory becomes 0D theory by omega deformation, 6D theory becomes 4D theory. Okay? And what you have to do is you take that formula and just plug it, this formula for the superpotential in. But the but remember the W was in this case is this well this 4D transforms action. So you immediately led to the conclusion that this 6D theory under the omega deformation reduces to this 4D transform theory. So this is nothing but the path integral for the 4D transform theory with H bar essentially given by epsilon. Therefore, you conclude that Fourier transform theory is nothing but 6D maximally supersymmetric Yamil theory, but topologically twisted and omega deformed on R2. And this path integral formula really provides a non-perturbative definition of Fourier transform theory, because now a gamma is constructed in such a way that this path integral really converges. So this is very similar to the story Witten's story of Witten's analytic continuation of quantum mechanics. No, well, you know, to really, yeah. So you can, of course, go. You can, of course, go to string theory. But what I said here is that this path integral defines Fourier transform theory. Namely, you really had to specify the integration contour in such a way that the path integral makes sense. So that was my claim.
I mean, that's the same thing that if you write down
functional integral. Sure. Of course.
Precisely define what you mean by
of course.
Integration.
And yes, of course. But that's sort of understood usually.
Right.
But here it's what the point is here the action is really a holomorphic function and this is really crucial. So
right, but the question is so there is a problem using all of these complex transforms.
Sure, sure.
Are you saying that you can do better or what are you saying?
No, what I just said is it's similar to that story.
So you cannot do that.
I mean, this is a different theory. This is not complex transform theory.
Right, but I'm asking you about the question.
Uh-huh. What problem Witten encounters? Well, that's you want me to make a bold statement, but
I'm trying to understand if you are
in another definition at all. It wasn't defined really. Okay, Fourier transform theory wasn't really defined non-perturbatively. In order to define it non-perturbatively, you have to define what integration contour you have to pick. That was the crucial missing information. But this analytical continuation stuff Witten, pioneered, that produces the integration contour.
So in a way, you are just repeating the homework version
for it. Yep. You can say that. Yeah, but with omega deformation. So there are differences also, because omega deformation plays a crucial role. But anyway, so that's it's getting technical. But so let me move on to string theory realization. Because now I have a 6D formulation of 4D sound theory, I can try to realize this 6D theory in string theory. Okay? So that's what I'm going to do.
Formulation, string theory realization, in order to define what you meant by the 6D theory that went into the formula on the previous
That's true,
slide.
Yes. Okay. Yes, so in order to really UV complete the 6D theory.
What's on the subsequent slides?
In order to UV complete the 6D theory, that's true.
Right.
But I've written down the path integral formula for 4D transcends. It's supplied with.
Is that path integral really defined independently of a definition of the 6D theory?
I believe so, but
it was a question, wasn't it? Yeah,
I think so, but that's what I think. All right, so let me move on. So now, because we want to construct 6D maximally supersymmetric MU theory, what you have to do is clear. You take a stack of N D5 brains and put them on a 6 manifold on the form M times C. Let's say, it's inside TSAR M times C. So this produces 6D maximally super MU theory with G gauge group UN, or if you discard the center of mass motion, then you get SUN. Okay. Now, the usual story is that normal flux directions are parameterized by the scalar fields, phi mu, in this 6D theory. But now, what the crucial point here is that these scalars are not really scalars, because normal directions are really fibers of the cotangent bundle. So they are the components of one form. So the world volume theory on D5s is actually topologically twisted in such a way that the scalar has become one form. Okay? So that's exactly the topological twist I used. So what you get is a twisted 6D maximally super MU theory. Okay? Now, what you need is the omega deformation. So to do that, you take M to be R2 times sigma. And it turns out that the omega deformation is more or less known how to create omega deformation in string theory is more or less known. It's what we have to use was something called the RR flux trap background studied by these authors, Hillerman, Orlando, and Refert. So this setup produces topologically twisted 6D maximally super MU theory with omega deformation, which is 4D transform theory. Okay, so that's how you embed 4D transforms into string theory. Now, what you need is Wilson lines. So it's clear how to create Wilson lines. You take open string ending on D5s. The endpoint acts like heavy charged particle. And as it moves, it traces out Wilson line. So that's that. So in this case, if you take a single open string, semi-infinite open string ending on N D5 brains, so endpoint can be any of N D5s, so there are N choices of D5s to end on, and this corresponds to the vector representation, okay? Because you have N states. Well, you can create other representations by introducing more brains and so on. Okay. Yep. Which one? This one? Oh, here? No, well, no, it doesn't. It's not half BPS, and it can curve actually. It can curve, actually. Well, when it curves, then this Wilson line has also has to turn in the orthogonal direction. Yeah, so it's quarter BPS. But there's a subtlety here about something to do with framing anomaly. But modulo that subtlety, Wilson line can be any curve inside sigma. Now, so this is the string theory realization of Floridian sum theory plus Wilson lines, therefore string theory realization of those integrable lattice models. Okay. Now, having understood this, we can apply dualities. Okay. Now, so one chain of duality that's very interesting is S duality followed by T duality in the horizontal direction of the torus, that's sigma. Okay, so under S duality, so D5 becomes NS5, and there are two different kinds of F1s in the lattice model. So one creates horizontal Wilson line, the other creates vertical Wilson lines. But anyway, so they all become D1s, and the Raman-Raman 2 form, C2 becomes a B field. Okay, that's how S duality acts. And then you apply T duality. NS5 remains as NS5s, and D1, which used to be horizontal Wilson line, becomes D0 because I'm applying T duality along the horizontal direction. But now D1 vertical become D2 vertical, D2. Okay? And B field actually remain as B field. So I get these objects. So for simplicity, let's take the simplest non-trivial case when you start with two D5 brains, then you get two NS5 brains, and picture looks like this brain, final brain configuration looks like this. Okay, you have two NS5 brains, and you have a bunch of D2 brains ending on either of the NS5 brains. Okay, and you also have the zero brain coming from the orthogonal direction, transverse direction, and ending on one of the NS5 brains. Okay, and now, so this configuration of D2 brains on NS5s, ending on NS5s, is labeled by an integer m, which is the number of D2s ending on the second NS5 brains. So this number, from the point of view of the lattice model or spin chain, is called the Magnus number. It just counts the number of up spins in the spin chain. Okay. Now, let's just forget about D0, and let's just look at D2 and NS5s. Well, this is actually a very famous brain configuration. When C is the complex plane and when there's no B field, the NS5 D2 part of the system realizes two-dimensional N equals 4.4 gauge theory with UM gauge groups, which come from this part of the D2 brains, with N hypermultiplets, which come from this part of the D2s. Okay, and it's described by this quiver. And here, well, the alphas are the coordinates of D2s in the vertical direction. And these determine the twisted masses, so mass parameters for these matter fields associated, and these masses are associated with the flavor group. Now you can turn on this B field, and what it does is also well understood. It gives further twisted masses to the theory, and it breaks N equals 4.4 supersymmetry to 2.2. Okay? So that's this theory. Now, generically, the theory described by this brain configuration is in the Higgs phase, which is because these two NS5 brains don't have the same X8 coordinate. And when these mass parameters are zero, so when Z alphas are all equal and there's no B field, it's known by the work of Witten that the theory flows to a sigma model, but it's topologically twisted and it's actually a model, and whose target space is the cotangent bundle of the Grassmannian M, N. Okay. And if you increase the number of brains, then you get you just have to replace the Grassmannian by a partial flag manifold. Okay. So this A model describes this system. Now you want to insert the D0 brain. Okay? D0 brain, it turns out that it represents a local operator in the 2D theory, and it actually generates the chiral ring. Okay? The chiral ring of the A model is the quantum cohomology ring of the target. Now, if you have non-zero generic mass parameters, so if you turn on Z alpha and B2, then this quantum cohomology is replaced by the equivariant version of the quantum cohomology. So this is the chiral ring. Now, from the point of view of the lattice model, what D0 does is to introduce the horizontal Wilson line. Okay? So what D0 represents this kind of picture, which is a transform matrix. But you remember that the transform matrix generates the conserved charges of the lattice model or spin chain. Okay? So you find the identification between the equivariant cohomology ring of the of T star in Grassmannian with the algebra of conserved charges of the XXX spin chain of length M, but you specify the Magnon number M. Okay? So you have this isomorphism, and that's nothing but the statement of 2D Nekrasov just really corresponds for this 2D theory. And what's nice about this brain construction is that it provides a concrete realization of this transform matrix in terms of D0 brain. So you can try to understand how D0 brain is represented in the left-hand side. Then you get a geometric understanding of the transform matrix, which has not been known. But this brain construction gives you how to do it. Tells you. Yep. So D0 came from Wilson line in the lattice model that's extending horizontally. Okay? Yes. So this horizontal line is really the D0 brain. So insertion of D0 into the theory is nothing but the insertion of this horizontal loop, which is the action of the transform matrix. Now, what you can do the following. You can replace the D2s in the brain picture with D4s. You can do that. If you do that, this D4 and S5 part of the system realizes 4D n equals 2 linear quiver theory. So it's a 4D n equals 2 theory, gauge theory described by this linear quiver. Okay. And in the original duality frame, if you follow the trace back the chain of dualities I applied, you see that D4s are really D3s. Okay? And the picture looks like this. So you had NS5s were actually D5s. And so here D4 comes and hits NS5. So in the original picture, D3 comes from the transverse direction hits D5s. Okay, and over some region, D3 and S5s combine. So this is the shaded region, and D3s leave the D5s and travels into the transverse direction. So in the lattice model picture, what you get is something like this picture. And so these shaded regions are actually surface operators inside it in the 4D transform theory. So these D4s create strips of surface operators in 4D transform theory. So by specifying, so these surface operators are located at certain points on the holomorphic direction C, and you have to specify a singular behavior of the gauge field there. Now, and you can think of these shapes of self-operators as nothing but a line operator, but it's just a little thick. And it turns out that these thick line operators carry an infinite dimensional representation of the gauge group. That's actually one module. And now you can insert the zero brain. It inserts a horizontal Poisson line, and it creates this transform matrix. But this transform matrix is nothing but the transform matrix of non-compact spin XXX spin chain, in which spins are in these representations, infinite dimensional representations. So that's what you find in the 4D version of Nekrasov-Shashvili correspondence. Okay, so 2D Nekrasov-Shashvili and 4D Nekrasov-Shashvili are combined, unified in 4D transcendent theory. The difference is just the difference in representation you choose for the vertical Poisson line. Okay, now, what about, because time's up, so let me summarize. So 4D transcendent theory, as I explained, arises naturally from omega deformed and topologically twisted 16 maximally supersymmetric Yamiot theory. And the latter theory can be embedded into string theory, and then you can use string dualities, which allow us to connect it to various other quantum field theories in which integrable systems have been found to arise. Okay? And you can do various sorts of things from here, because in string theory, you can think about infinitely many different combinations of dualities. And for each such choice of chain of dualities, you get some quantum field theory set up. And for each such quantum field theory set up, you should be able to identify the structure of integrable lattice models or integrable spin chains. Okay, so you should be able to find vastly many examples of integrability appearing from gauge theories or some field theories. Okay. And in this talk, I explained how Poisson lines lead to transform matrices, which are called T operators in integrable model literature. But there are something also called Q operators, and it turns out that they arise from top lines instead of Poisson lines. So that's a work in progress with Kevin and David Gaiotto. And of course, I would like to relate this everything to spin chains, which arise in the context of ADS CFT, but that's like a very ambitious goal at the moment. Okay, so thank you. Yes. Yeah, so for open string chains, what you have to do is you don't want to make a lattice on torus, but you want to make a lattice in which the horizontal direction is not a circle. Okay? Then at some point I apply T duality in the horizontal direction of the torus, but that's no longer available. I can't apply T duality, but I can still apply S duality. Then what I get is instead of D4, D0, NS5, I get D3, D1, NS5. So, and this brain system realizes 3D N equals 4 linear quiver theory, which is a dimensional reduction of the 4D linear quiver theory. But then this theory, inside this theory, you should be able to find the structure of open spin chain, which has a vastly larger symmetry algebra, which is the Jungian. Okay, so this explains why Jungian has been found to arise in this particular theory. Yep, in the horizontal direction, yes. What you do is you choose initial and final states on the Poisson line. Right. Yes, that's because you want to preserve a certain amount of supersymmetry. Well, you need the supercharge, And then in order to do that, because I can only topologically twist along M, but not along C, so C has to be flat so that supersymmetry is not broken. Okay. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, that's also a possible explanation if you start with from 4D transforms. So here I'm starting with 6D theory.
I think also because of
spectral complexity. I mean this explains why you have three different classes of integrable systems.